Welcome to the Data Science with R class. We are now in the Unit 4 talking about natures of data. So when we were talking about nature of data, we need to understand the data types. One, we are going to call it as a structured data. So when we call it as a structured data, we assume or it is pertained that it is a highly organized information, right? So we can make some meaningful inferences there itself, because it is in a model what we can call it as a relational database management system, and probably it is in form of a tabular way where we can have a precise and good inferences towards the structured content. Next one was a unstructured data. So especially it is a, I can say it is a opposite way of a structured, and it is going to be divided on any underlying structure. So we need to convert from unstructured data to a structured data with a lot of primitive operations, and thereby we can make an essential insight. So working straight away with the structured data is more easy and readability, where a simple search operation can be performed. But when we take up it is an unstructured data, there is some underlying architecture which need to be modified so that it can be converted from one form of data to another form. So here is an example what we were talking about, a structured data. So in this structured data, we do have some table here with customer ID, SEC, is employed, income, marital status, housing type, number of vehicle, age, and status of the residents. So now we can see that the data was totally structured, that we have a complete information of the record. So or we can have a complete information of row. So what was the ages of the different customers? So obviously I can call it as 49, 40, 22, 22, 31. So we get some meaningful inferences. So here you can say that 60 is to be the height, and then 120 can be a width. So in this way, we are able to look into this issue. Similarly, we even can mention the data types also. We even can mention the data types. So what will be the data types means, as we mentioned in our earlier discussion, that it can be numeric, it can be character, so ordinal, ratio, scale, interval. So so all those implications can be totally replicated in the tabular way. So such is what we call here as numbers as one set, text as another set, and Boolean. So Boolean, I can say whether the person is employed or not. So we don't know the value, so we call here at not available. So actually we need to give some data into it, but we are unable to provide. So that may pertain to some missing values. So instead of missing values and other anomalies, so we check that data to be in form of NA. So that is where we mentioned here. And similarly, we have housing dot type, where housing dot type we meant that what type of house he had, whether he is living in a rented house, whether he is occupied with no rent, or whether he is the house owner. So what category he is going to have. So an employees, they do have some housing allowance, they do have their benefits, so it is occupied with no rent. And in this way we have some three or four classes of living styles. So that is where it is replicated with this housing type. Similarly, the categorical data, which it is with the two aspects, One, it is gender discrimination with male and female, and that is with sex, and followed by the marital status, that is whether it is married or never married. So in this way, we have some another two classes mentioned up there. So in this way, we are able to build up the categorical data. So all those implications, they can be truly found in the structured data. But when we are going to take up this unstructured data, the data is without labels. So that was the most crucial part. So we need to apply human cognition and divide it and bifurcate it into different classes, and thereby we need to understand what type of data it was. So now you can see here, it is when we write some email, etc., it is in paragraphs. It is totally in a paragraph, and it is difficult to understand. It is difficult to understand. So now that unstructured content, we should get some storytelling, we should get some insights in a brief. So how well it can be taken up. And second thing was the unstructured data, it is going to make a lot of complications of organizing unstructured content. So you do have some time, you do have some energy to be consumed by the human, so that it can be giving up to some implications or some storytelling to get a quick insights of what was into that content. So it needs to be, the data has to be transformed into from structured data. So from unstructured data need to be transformed to the structured data. So that was the way we need to look into this issue. So similarly, there is a email, which is a classic example for the unstructured data. So we write up the emails, and we see that we have a classification of inbox, promotions, updates. So in this way, but it doesn't mean that spam, etc. It doesn't mean that we are doing a good labeling. No, but we need to work the text which is inside it. We need to work which is inside it. But even though we are going to organize it to different labels, but still we need to see how the content was there. Based on that content only, we need to get the meaningful insight. So that is how we say that email is also one of a classical thing to be of a unstructured data. So what was the solution was? The solution was to arrange the things into Excel sheet, they arrange things into spreadsheets, where it is going to be in form of some relational data, so that it can have some quick insights, quick understanding what was going on around the information. So that is where it should be converted from unstructured content to the structured content. So now we were talking about structured data, unstructured data, and semi-structured data. It is a composition of both structured and unstructured. Now let us look some of the aspects where the nature of data to be still looked at. So we have just went up to a nominal, ordinal, ratio scale, interval scale, etc. Then we took up quantitative, qualitative, and thereby we talked about structured, unstructured. Now let us see this, what is the other ways of looking up into the data. First thing was how we are going to able to collect the data, from where we are going to get the data. So first type, we call it as open data. So open data, yeah, it is available in the public domain. So that was the key takeaway from this slide, that there we have a data, and that data, it can be taken up from public domain. So there is no restrictions. So this is what we need to understand here. There is no restrictions at all. So we don't bulge into the copyright, patents, or other mechanisms of controlling. As it is, put it in an open mode, yeah, we can have a free access to get that data. So what will be some of the features when we are going to look it into the data collection? One, we call it as public. So it is permitted by law, by default. So when I'm putting something into my public domain, it implicates that the data is open to all, anybody can access it. So that is where this permitted by law, and despite that, it do have some authentication that you should be acknowledged. So that is where subject to privacy, you should be referred, you should be cited. So that should be taken up. And second thing was, when the public data it was there, now there should be some restrictions, there should be some validations for us, because as it is in public domain, somebody should not modify your data and create a lot of trouble to you. So when we put some data into the content, yeah, obviously it is permitted by law, it is subject to privacy, do have confidentiality, do have security, and give some valid restrictions over the data. Next, the other features, what it can take up as part of a data collection was, we are going to call that one as a accessibility. So when it is going to be accessible, it should be readily available. It should be readily be available all the time. So round the clock, it should be readily available and free accessible to download. So it can be convenient, it can be modificable, and it should be of some open format. So it can be .csv format or JavaScript oriented notation format. So it should be in a specific order, a generic order. We can say here it is a generic order. So where it can be adapted to any type of operating system atmosphere or in any type of environment it does fit. And thereby the accessibility was it to be retrieved, it can be downloaded, it can be indexed, and it should be allowing us to make some searching. Next one was the third feature was the open data should be a machine, I mean the human should be able to understand it. So when human should be able to understand it, the data what we are putting in a domain, public domain, should have a description. So what exactly the data telling was. So if I'm going to have height, okay, should we measure it in centimeters or should we measure it in meters? So if I'm going to give it some milk, so obviously I give it in liters. So whether it is gallons or etc. So I was just telling you an example that I'm, as it is a milk, now the measuring quantity I'm going to describe it. So in this way, similarly, I put some body mass index. So how is this, whether it is a continuous value or whether it is a, how you are going to get that value. So that description, the documentation should be provided. So for the open data, until unless that, if that is not understood, people cannot go with inferences to process on the data. So documentation of the data elements and data dictionary, the metadata should be provided along with the open data, because when we do with an analytics part, that should be understood first in order to dig deep into data and understand what was its underlying structure. Yeah, there are few more points which can be taken up with the data collection. One, we are going to call it as a reusability. That is, open data can be made available under an open license. And then we have completeness. So it can be have a primary forum where people can publish it. For example, we do have a UCI data sets. We have University of Irvine data sets. That is the UCA data sets followed by Kaggle data set. There are a lot of government repositories where the data was primarily open, and it is where it is a public domain where people can come and access that. So that completeness, it is going to be happening. Next one, it is to be preserved timely to timely, and whatever frequent releases of data happened, that should be given. So I get a 3.1 version, I do a 3.2 version. So it is, I can say it is on updated on so and so date. So we need to mention it. So when we are going to give it new release, so what was the upgradations we have made? So that should be taken up properly in a timely order. So managing the post-release instance. So you can say it can assist the data and reuse to respond to complaints and about adhering to those of open data requirements. So that is what we are going to call here as a post-release. So any type of complications can occur, and that complication should be adhered, and that issue should be rectified, etc. The next way where the nature of data is going to talk up will be the social media data. Then we are going to say it is a social networking or a social media data. Yeah, we can have a lot of examples, like Facebook, like Twitter, and WhatsApp or an Instagram. So these are some of the examples, and there are a lot of curves. So social media data, they are going to be a goldmine for collecting data and to analyze research or marketing purposes. So why these people are able to get where exactly data was available, so they were able to research and get the data. But actually the repositories, yeah, we have enough examples I was telling, like Kaggle and UCI data sets. So there are repositories, and those are also hosted in the public domain. So now these, they are going to be supported with application programming interfaces, API we call it as, and they do a lot of research, they do a lot of development in order to exhibit the data to use to the users. And how people are going to collect the data was that they are going to use some certain data structures. They are going to use some certain data structures to organize or to navigate the data. So one of such, we call it as some graphs or one in form of trees. So data was organizing in that way. So the API is going to support the graph-like structure. So where people can look for insights, whether they can check and they can have some connectivity to find the connectivity among the sentences, or what we can say among the content, what it was taking and what was the context. So what was the context set, whether there is some relevance, or not. So that it is going to be understood when we are building up this graphs, etc. Yeah, yes, just we taken up. So data sets has often been released by social media platforms itself. So one of an example people here in this discussion, we can have YELP. So it is going to be a popular crowdsourced review platform. So there we do have some content regarding to the local businesses, and it is a public domain repository where it is one of an example which was taken up via the social media data. So at that Yelp, I can say YELP, so what they are going to host, they are going to host some images. So that is and from that, what we are going to check it up, or what type of analysis we are going to do. We are going to do some supervised learning. We are going to do some learning, because we do some automatic photo classification. So we have the existing pic, and then we are going to put new pick, and then we are going to make some compare operation. So if it is true, yeah, we will put into this bucket, otherwise we can say that it is not classified. So in this way we do some automatic picture or a photo classification. So that is where it is one of an example that ELP was taking. Similarly, it is does some natural languages processing, where it is looking up some multiple linguistic, that is the different languages, and that it can be uniformly converted to one certain language and thereby get up some insights from it. So similarly, it do some sentiments which is going to be polarized, and that sentiments it is going to make some graphic mining. So sentiment was that whether there is a winning context, there is a election campaign. So election campaign. So in this election campaign, so it sets whether the contestant win or loss. So or a positive sentiment or a negative sentiment. So how was the mindset? How was the mindset of the people? So we need to analyze. We need to analyze. So for that, we have this sentiment analysis, and it connects nodes and understand how our majority of people are doing this. So in this way, we polarize it into different labels, into different classes, and thereby give some meaningful storytelling insights. So such is where one of an example for this LP is helping in. And another type of social media, why this LP is going to bring up, will be the multimedia data. So this multimedia data, yeah, it is going to analyze the things of brain image data. So when we are going to call it as a brain image data, we do have red, green, blue, then we have this grayscale images, and then we have the monochrome images. So in this way, there should be some conversion mechanism from red, green, blue to grayscale images, and thereby from to the monochrome images, and then we can make some comparative study on this multimedia content. Next, it is with towards the sequencing. Next, it was a sequencing with some set of series, and how far it is different with the subject, or how far it is relevant to the subject. We need to identify those sequencing. So such is where this data analysis is going to check up. So what we talked up to now was that we have data collections, that is its features are public and accessible, described, reusable, complete, timely, and managed. And then we talked about the social media interface where we can analyze the data, and some of an example we called it as ALP. And ALP, it is providing up the automatic photo classification, the sentiment analysis, and it also does some multimedia data working and generates sequencing, etc. Next is another example of the nature of data. Another example towards the nature of data was the multimodal data. So this multimodal data, it is going to connect to the internet, and then it is going to create on emerging trends of IoT, that is Internet of Internet of Things. And so we do have this multimodal data. It can deal with numbers, it can deal with text, and of course it is going to have some multimedia information, that is audio information, a video information, with series of pictures, with series of music, sound, gestures, body postures. So a lot of information is going to be mingled into a single data, such is where we say it is multimodal. So when we are going to call it as a multimodal, then it do have text, it do have numbers, it does have audio, it does have video, it does have images, animations. So all these are mixed up. So where we have another type of data, that is what we call here as a multimodal data. So this multimodal data, yeah, of course, it can be taken up in form of either structured thing, or it can be taken up into unstructured thing. So one of an example of this multimodal thing was, it is brain image data sequencing data set. So it is going to have some images which are taken from the sensors. So from a scanning room, the sensors are going to bring up the elements. The laser light is hit on the body, and some sensors are going to be activated by a machine, and that there the data is going to be captured, and that data need to be analyzed in form of EEG, MEG, fMRI. So that is medical image techniques. So there they are going to get this data. So how is this data, the multimodal data has? So it has some text, it is going to have some image, it is going to have some video, then it is going to have some audio. So then text, yeah, it can be numeric and it can be character. So obviously, so now what is multimodal data? So multimodal data, it does have text, it does have images, it does have image videos, and it does have audio. So all this, when we take up with the medical image data, all such data need to be addressed, it need to be processed, and thereby the insights has to be brought. So that is what the nature of this multimedia data is looking at. Yeah, so we talked about this unstructured data. Now let us see some comma separated value, which it is going to be the structured data approach. So when we are going to call it as a structured data approach, it does have data storage and presentation. So CSV, we call it as .csv. We call the full form, that is comma separated values. And this is can be a common import to a spreadsheet, to Excel sheet, and to a databases. So most of the platforms, so it is readily available or has a usability on multiple environments. So it is going to be more or less like a flat file. It is more or less like a flat file. So it can be compatible to any operating system. So that was the advantage which was given into the CSV. So it can open in a text, it can open in a spreadsheet, and thereby we can look for analysis what exactly was inside the data. So that is what we say it is more generic, and it can be shareable always to anyone. So that was the basic advantage of the comma separated values to present the data. So here is the name, we can call it as the data set here. So this data set name, we are going to call it as a depression here. So now I can say treat before, after, difference. So these four items, these four, we are going to call it as some attributes. We are going to call here as an attributes. So now this attribute, now you can you can look into this treat. Now I can call treat, it is going to be some ordinal or a nominal category. Why? Because it is having N, it is having P, it is going to have S, and it does have E. So there are four class labels, right? And in the similar way, I have a difference. So difference, yeah, it can be some continuous values. So it falls under some numeric class. So in this way, we should first of all understand what was happening. So I'm going to have a reading. I'm going to have a reading that is before, and then I'm going to have some after. So this is what I can say. It is 13, 10. Then we are going to have this difference. So the 10 minus 13. So in this way, we are going to have some differential values, and thereby we do have ordinal, and that it is going to give up the class label. So depression, no treatment, depression with no placebo, depression with Seroxel, and depression having another label called as Effectrol. Yeah, another type of looking up into the nature of data was the tab separated values. So in this tab separated values, we use the usage of hypertext markup language. One of an example I can take up. So that is tab separated values. So files, they are going for raw data, and they can be imported or exported to some spread softwares. And of course, they are going to be essentially part of this text files and raw data. It can be viewed by the text editors. So now here is an example what we are going to discuss it here. That is, we bring up this name, then we are going to have some separation, and followed by age, and again we are going to have tab. So this is all tags. We are going to have the tags. The tags we are going to put in form of tab, and which it is going to use separation of data, which it is going to use for a separation of data. So we have Samantha here, followed by separated, and the age what we are going to give, and again the address where she lives. So in this way we are going to take up the data, and then first of all we are going to describe the attribute. So name, it is going to be Samantha. Age, it is going to be some 32. Address, it is going to be some George Street. So in this way we are going to give up the first the attributes, thereby we are going to give up the data items. So before first item, second item, we need to have some space. That space we are going to build up with this tab, and tab, it is going to occupy the 12 characters, and tab, it is going to occupy the 12 characters. So one more form of bringing up the nature of data was the extendable markup language. So this extensible markup language, in shortcut, we are going to call it as XML. So XML stands for extensible markup language. So why we are going to look this, the thing was, the web, if it is going to be taken up with this HTML, etc., then it is going to be totally a unstructured way. But from this unstructured way, now we need to have some meaningful inferences, and to have some structured approach, then we need some tags, we need some mechanism which does. So it gives structured data, and it is can be stored in database with structured or ordering. So that is the advantage why we are going to use up this XML language, and it is both human readable, machine readable, and it can be used to store, and it can be transportable data. That in sense that as it is taking up the web format www, so it can work on Opera, it can work on Firefox, it can work on Edge or Chrome. So any type of browser, this extensible markup language has its compatibility, and there itself the data can be derived directly, and data can be retrieved, informed, and it can be searched, navigated according to the user's need. So how is the data which is in the XML stored? Was it is going to be stored in a plain text, and this is one of the key feature what we need to understand, that is software and hardware independent of storing. And it can be taken up directly to the database. So XML can be moved to database, and it can be stored permanently. So that's where we can make some simplifications, and not only it supports relational databases, but it also going to support some object oriented way of bringing the things. So that is what we call it as object oriented storage, and these are some of the basic definition what we look with this extensible markup language. This is an example what we are going to talk about. So when we have this tag, extensible markup language tab, we need to indicate this. So how we are going to indicate this was, we start up with a question mark, and to mention it that the steps which are going to be followed, they are going to be with the XML content. So XML, it is dealing with multiple devices, multiple platforms, and service relaying for the same data. Now we are going to have some bookstore. So bookstore, it is a custom or it is a user defined tag. So in bookstore, now what we are going to have, we have a book, then we have its title, then we have its author, then the year it is, then we have its price. So when we talk about a book, so we are mentioning this is level one book, it is level two, and then we say it is end book. So end book here, so this is end of level two, and again this is end of level two followed by end of level one. So what we are going to bring up this story was, so the tag what we pose at this position, it is going to be a database. From the database, we have a record or we have a row. So what is the database here? Database, we are going to call it as book store. Then the record, it was talking about the book, and we have the attributes, we have the columns, that it is title, author, year, price, etc. So it is totally meant for one record. In this same fashion, it can be having a multiple records. So that is where this XML is going to bring up, and it gives a structure. So second time, if I want to give one more record, again I have to take this bookstore to content. So this is again I have to repeat this, I have to iterate it and put up books, title, author, year. So these are custom tags or user-defined tags. So you made this book, you need to close the book, you need close the book. You made a price, then you need to end the price, year, end the year, author, end the author name. So in this way, we need to mention up these items. So that gives a structured approach to the data. That is the significance of this XML operation. So along with this XML operation, we do have this RSS. So RSS stands for really simple syndication. So RSS, it is going to be the advanced or the next level of XML. So that is RSS feeds. So that is really simple syndication. So it is a basic format where data can be stored between certain services, and where it is going to facilitate delivery of information across different sources of the web. So along with the XML, the next level was to look into RSS, that is really simple syndication. So it is a way where the data can be transformed or exchanged to different sources over a web. So the services are going to be provided across the web, and that it is going to be taken up with this RSS. So RSS, yeah, it does has the basic support, that is HTML, then it goes with XML, then it is going with the RSS content. So in general, RSS data, it is why it is going to be taken up was it is purely used in the personal digital assistants. It is small and fast loading. Hobby, we look at in traveling in a bus, the conductors are holding one device. They give the tokens immediately. They give the tickets immediately. In the petrol pumps also, we swipe our debit card, we swipe our credit card. So we generate a slip, we get a meter reading, and our amount was deducted from our debit card and I mean our credit card and transferred to the other end. How is the mechanism it was working up? So that mechanism, it is one of a classic example for this RSS. So it is purely tied up with the internet, and it does have its own type of tagging, and obviously it is going to provide small and fast loading content. So not all the websites can deal up or can use the functionality of an RSS. Yeah, it can be taken up for news, it can be taken up with companies with the launching of new products, etc. and a website which have some calendaring events. So similarly, such a website with some site changes, which is going to update new pages, new content. So all those websites, they are going to look into the RSS. So some of an examples I was mentioning that it will be news sites, so which will be keep on updating commonly. Similarly, a company will launch new products and there it needs to get some derivative insights for it. So for that also, they are using this RSS. And a website which does a lot of calendaring events and noting up the important days, etc. So for that also, this RSS is going to be a big solution or a better solution for it. Now, RSS can take up into two ends. It needs two ends. One, it is at client. Another, it is going to be at the server end. So it needs two ends. One, it is going to be at a client end. Another, it is going to be at a server end. So as mentioned, so we can XML, it is there. So we can derive. We are going to derive. We are going to derive the have own tags, right? So what was the own tag here? I do have a channel and I open this, I have a closed channel. Now you can see this funda, that is RSS we were mentioning here, and its version we are going to mention in the XML itself. So XML, yeah, it is going to provide up the structured content here. So now you can see this channel to channel. So these are all user defined tags. So we can call it as some custom tags. So it does have title with end title, some link giving up where exactly the home page of the author is available. So in this way, we are going to describe the content. So we have this item tag, item begin to item end. So now you can see we are able to give some website links. We are able to give some customized links here. So such customized links are not feasible to the earlier context of HTML. Now in this RSS, now it is a way where people are going to give up their site links. So this link type of content, it was not available in the previous versions of HTML or the XML. Now when it is incorporated with the RSS, now this it is going to have a link and boots up the links, direct links. So that helps us. Even the link can be identified in a structured format. Another interesting way of looking up this JSON, that is of nature of data. Nature of data, it was the JavaScript object notation. So it is JavaScript object notation. So we say it is JSON file. So it is going to be a lightweight data interchange format. So why this JSON is going to have its importance in the current trending was we have numerous data, enormous data, high amount of data is going to be available. But how the data was stored was data, it is going to be stored in form of dictionaries. In form of dictionaries, data it is going to be stored. There it is going to have some keys and value pairs. So that gives a meaningful structured approach towards data, and it can be flexibly accessed to any type of compatible software. That I can say it is platform independent. So it can be applied to any type of platform. So iOS, nor a Windows, nor an Android. So any type of operating system atmosphere. So it is a platform independent, and it can be flexibly accessed across the net. So that is why, and similarly, JSON, it is very easy to parse, scan, or parse towards the usage while working with the machine. because there it is again supporting from the compiler code to the bytecode. So the same context is also posed over this JSON. So how is this JSON taken up? So JSON, it is going to be taken up with two structures. One, it is going to have a collection in form of names and value, that is key value pairs, as I was mentioning, and it can be realized with some set of data structure. It can be mentioned with some set of data structure, and that it can be with dictionaries, it can be with hashed keys, it can be identified with a record or a object or with some type of listing structure or an arrays. So, and one more key impending element towards this JSON file was, we do have some ordered list of values. So that the ordered content is going to be happen in this JSON file. So it can be realized with arrays, vectors, lists, or sequence. So to any form of data structure, JSON has its compatibility. So you can migrate it towards a array, you can use it towards a vector, to a list and sequence, and thereby you can use this contents here. So JSON, yeah, it can be exchanged between a browser and the server. That was the main intention of digging deep to the concept of JavaScript object notation. So that is the primary way. And as mentioned, we do have a sending of a data towards the JSON file. So it is going to be stored over a JavaScript, and it is platform independent, and it can be converting the objects into the JSON file, and it sends to the browser. So here I'm going to take up this first HTML, simple HTML code here. So we mentioned the doc type of the HTML, HTML begin, HTML end, HTML body, HTML end of HTML body. Then we are going to mention a paragraph here with some identifier to code the paragraph demo. So in future, if you want to link up this paragraph, you can directly call it with an ID demo dot, and then we can work directly towards the paragraph. So that is the advantage of giving a identifier here. So now we are going to put this in the JavaScript. Now we are going to put this in the JavaScript here. So now we define this as a key value pair. So name, it is going to be John. Age, it is going to be 25. State, it belongs to New Jersey. So in this way, we are going to bring up the object for this. So what we have done, we have taken up the attribute 1, attribute 2, attribute 3. So we have key and we have value, and they are paired here. So multiple records can be taken up with appropriately giving name, age, and state. We are able to give it. And next one was, now we need to have this conversion mechanism to a JSON file. So how we are going to do is, we defined this as an object, and that object we are stringifying it to a JSON. We are stringifying it to a JSON. So that was the key context in order to send the data right from to the server. The very first step was, we have created an object with a key value pair with name, age, and state, and thereby that has to be migrated to a JSON file. So how we are going to provoke was, we call this with the package JSON with the method stringify and assign the value there, and followed by this location. So where exactly or what file it is going to have. So it is a PHP file, and we save this the file name. This is file name, and another one, the PHP file, it is file extension. And then we put this variable. So the name of a variable, it is going to be object underscore JSON. So entire thing, yeah, it is put between script and end of a script. That too, we are doing it at the sending end. Now let us look the unpacking content that is happening at the receiving end. So here we have packed the content. So packing up the content with object, name, age, state, etc. So we packed the content, we stringified it with an object, and then we created the page, and then we concatenated the object JSON to the window location. So that is all taken up at the client end. Now from this client end, now the data was mitigated towards the receiving end or towards the server end. Now we can have this doc file. Again, I do have this HTML file, begin HTML, then have a body file, end body file. Then again, a paragraph is going to classify to identify what was going on the page. So that we call here as a demo file. Then we were deriving up this script followed by end script. So now we have this variable as it is, that is object JSON. So the variable was JSON, and what does it contain? It contains name and John, age and 25, and state and New Jersey. Now we need to have parsing. So why need to, we need to have a parsing? We need to separate the keys. We need to separate the keys. So we can plunge this age, name, and state, and thereby we can put it into a database for storage. So how we can separate was, now we are going to put this into another local variable called as an object. We do parsing. So this was key notation here. We are going to do up the parsing. And how we are going to do this? We are going to get element by element. So what will be the element by element? First element, I am going to have name. Second element, I am going to have this age. Third element, I am going to have the state, and followed by its associated value. What is the associated value? I have John, I have 25, I have New Jersey. So this is all the associated values which are available inside this key value pair. So that one we are going to get it from the document. We are going to get it from the document what it was received from the other end. So that's why we are called here as some document dot get element by ID. So the name of a paragraph, yeah, we mentioned it as a demo. So now we are going to call up at this item, and dot, we are going to call the method. So there we are going to say inner HTML, and we are assigning with the object name. So in this way, from server to client and client to server, we are able to exchange these JSON files. So let us recap of what we have done at this moment of time. So we are talking about the nature of data. So in nature of data, we talked about the different aspects. That is one, we talked about the unstructured data followed by the structured data. So we made those two differences. After that, we made with the data collection. It takes up with the, it is going to take up with the publicity. It is going to, it is going to take up with the publicity, followed by accessibility, followed by describedness. And another features will be the reusability, the completeness, the timeliness, and the post-release content. Then there are another nature of data, that is where the social networking sites like Facebook, Twitter, WhatsApp, or Instagram, they are maintaining up the data in form of some data structure to have some meaningful insights. That is the social media data, what we discussed. And they do a lot of content that it can be with image processing, that is with some automatic photo classification, or does with some natural language processing to work on different linguistic models. And basically those they are going to call here as a multimedia data or a multimodal data, because they does sequencing, they have they does sequencing, and they deal with some images, music, sounds, etc. So that is where this brain scanning images or the multimodal modalities of a data is going to be described. And another way of giving up the structured data was the data storage and presentation. It is taken up in form of comma separated values. It is a platform independent and readily available. So it is called as a flat files, and they are compatible to any type of operating systems, and they are more generic and they can be reusable at any point of time. So they support nominal, ordinal, ratio scale, interval scale. Any type of data can be taken up in this comma separated values. The another form was a tab separated value. A tab separated value has a characteristic of 12. So I can give a name instead of space, I give a tab, and thereby I'm going to give age. So name and age, they are going to be given the headers for that column. And now the content towards that column, we have Samantha here, and we have given an age, and we have given the address. So in this way, we are going to give up this tab separated values. Next one was to bring up the extensible markup language. So it is giving up a structured content over the World Wide Web. So directly the data can be stored or linked to a database and have a structured reforms and a meaningful insights. So storing, retrieving of data is more simple, and across multiple platforms data can be accessed. So how I'm going to take up this XML was, I do have a question mark followed by XML. So that is where the XML content starts. And then instead of predefined contents of HTML like body, header, foot, H1 to H6, in this model, these are all predefined tags. Similarly, user can bring up his own tags. So that was the advantage of giving up here. So you have bookstore. And to maintain the record, we have a book. And then the attributes are taking up with title, author, age, and prices. So in this model, we are going to derive this XML content. And nowadays, people do have their timely feedbacks, timely updates over the web. That is with the calendar, that is with the companies or new sites they are going to maintain. So that it is going to be taken up with a really simple syndication. So that is an advanced version from the XML. And of course, they are going to be also supporting the structured format. And the basic examples of this really simple syndication was at the petrol pump. We do have the personal digital assistants, where we use a debit card or credit card and transfer money from our account to the other. So that is one of the best classical example where this RSS is going to work up. And after RSS, the most renowned way of one of a data format was the JavaScript object notation, which we are going to call it as JSON. So it is going to have a structure where it stores in key value formats, and it can be compatible to move the data to an array, to a vector, to a list, or to a sequence, to any set of operation it is going to have. So JSON, yeah, it can be taken up as part of a JavaScript code. So it can be included between script and end of a script, between these scripting tags of the JavaScript. So how we are going to take up was, we derive a variable name with some name called as an object. We put up the key value, the attributes, and multiple contents also we can put up. And finally, we can assign it to a stringify function of a JSON package and send it to the source end. So we are going to put this into a PHP file called as demo and send to the other end. When it reaches to the other end, that it should be navigated, it should be used. So how we are going to bring this was, we are going to do the parsing. And after doing the parsing, we are going to get it element by element. That is, we get the first element John, 2S25, and 3S New Jersey. So that's is the easiness what the nature of data is going to provide. So this is all from the word called as nature of data. That too, especially it is going to use up in this data science.